Unmute. Okay, hello everybody.
Hi.
Hi.
Well, that was a little tricky. Oh, let's see, we've got Tori, I see Brent, Linda, good to see you again. I see Billy Manson, I see Dr. Levin, hello Karen. And we don't have quorum yet. Do we, Karen? Nope. I see. Okay.
Yeah. Let's see one more. Well, I guess with you, Marky, we do because it, you, Tori, Brent, and Linda.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do we know if Greg is going to be able to join us? I think he's traveling. And it was an issue.
Yeah, he said it might be iffy based on his travel schedule.
And is Patty going to join us in his place?
I did reach out. Let's see, I think he was going to connect with her, but I don't think I heard the answer.
Okay.
She was going to be able to. And we're missing Dr. Kurt and let's see.
Patty was in the county offices. This is Phyllis. So let me email Charlotte and see. She can't run her down.
Okay, let's run her down, but let's go ahead and call the meeting to order. We do have quorum. So with that said, people that are here, members of the board and the alternates, obviously Marky Butler here from Snowman's Village, Tori, Brent Miller, Linda Vieira, and Billy Madsen alternate, and let's go ahead and get started. In terms of the minutes, do I have a motion for approval of the minutes from the previous meeting?
I can motion it.
Thank you very much, Linda. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you very much. All in support, just raise your right hand. Okay. It was interesting going back through the slides this morning from 2 weeks ago, and it's amazing what has happened even in 2 weeks. And looking at the data from today, and I look forward to listening to Josh and to Kimberly. So let's jump right into the discussion points. Karen, would you like to introduce?
Sure, yeah, thank you. And we are having a little bit of a transition, or we are having a transition today. So Charlie, we were working with Charlie on contract. He's slowly morphing out of his contract right now. He's doing some other work for us, but we're really transitioning Josh into the chief epidemiological role. And so Josh is going to lead us off with the data from the epi side, and then Dr. Levin will bring in the hospital side. And I said, I think all of us are going to be really sad that we don't get Charlie's historical perspective right from the get-go. And we didn't want to push Josh into that role, but he's going to bring his own unique flair to the epi data. So excited to have him be able to share that with you this morning or this afternoon.
Well, welcome, Josh. It's great to see you finally know what you look like. So welcome, an incredible board and a wonderful community, and hope you're enjoying yourself. And let's go ahead and listen to your presentation.
Karen, am I sharing my slides, or are we having Lindsay?
Lindsay
do it?
Said that she may be able to share all of our slides for us. Okay. So if that would help us out, I know it'll help me.
So Zuho is going to kick us off real quick with this tribute to Charlie.
Thanks, Josh, and thanks, Karen and Marky. Just as Karen mentioned, we're kind of transitioning Charlie's role over to Josh, but also wanted to take a little bit of time to really thank Charlie for all of the work that he's done. He was so quick to jump right in. This was a quote from an email we received from CDPHE less than 2 weeks after we first had a case connected to Pitkin County, and had no idea who this Charlie Spickert was, but you know, CDPHE was strapped and not able to help every county at the time, but Charlie was willing to jump right in. I don't know if you're listening, Charlie, but thank you so much for all of the work that you did, just jumping right in, helping us with all of our contact tracing and data and testing, and really kind of putting your life on pause for a little bit to be able to help us out, not just for the first 3 months that we had talked about, but even still today and through the rest of this month. So really grateful for all of your work driving to the IMT early on during this pandemic and providing the historical overviews, as Karen mentioned, during your presentations as well. We really believe that you're a critical part in our efforts to help save lives through this pandemic, not just from the case investigations that you did and all of that analysis, but also with the infrastructures that you helped create for us. So thank you again for all of your work. And, we are grateful for everything that you've done for us.
And Charlie, if you are listening, on behalf of the board, it's been an honor, a privilege, and absolute joy to work with you. And I will miss your wonderful stories. It's always been one of the highest delights that I've had in terms of really understanding the historical perspective of what brings us all together at this point. So thank you, Charlie.
And Charlie invited me over to his house for the first week I was here, and we sat down together, and he really kind of gave me an intro to this role and to just an overview of what the community's like. And so again, thanks, Charlie, for doing that and for really, you know, kind of giving me that perspective. So as Karen mentioned, Charlie would give a more of a historical perspective or update. So what I wanted to do is, in light of what Charlie did, was to look at some other countries and discuss how what they're doing and how they're handling the coronavirus pandemic. And maybe some lessons that we can learn here as well. So this is Rwanda, and Rwanda's interesting. It's right in the heart of Africa, but they have a pretty unique setup. They, when they go to their hospitals or medical centers, many of them have robots, and these robots do screening for patients so that they don't have to have any interaction with an actual medical provider. So these robots, they speak to them, they give them some information on COVID and what to expect, and then they go and do the screening for the individuals there. So they have a pretty unique setup there in the medical facility. They also do random street testing there in Rwanda. So someone's walking down the street, you might run into a doctor or someone else who's doing testing, and they'll test you right there on the spot to get some asymptomatic and random testing to try to determine the prevalence there in Rwanda. So it's pretty interesting. What they've also been doing, and I'm not sure if they're still doing this, but they have had every single positive patient, regardless of symptomatic or asymptomatic, they've had them all go to one facility. So they take all those people and put them in the same spot, just to ensure that they know where everyone who has COVID is at. Then finally, what they do is they do pool testing. And this is more of a concept that's been discussed more recently. But pool testing is where you take, and what they're doing there in Rwanda is they take 25 samples from individuals, and they put them all together in the same bowl or type of reagent, and they test them all together. And if they come back negative, if the whole pool comes back negative, then they know that nobody in that pool is positive. And so they use less reagent, and they also have a lot more, a much quicker turnaround time. So they've had a lot of success with that. If they do get a positive, the image there shows you what they do. They then divide it in half and they retest both the samples, and they keep narrowing it down until they find the positive or the several positives. So they've had a lot of success with that. So Rwanda's had a pretty low case count overall, just a few thousand cases. They were comparing it to Ohio, and Rwanda's really just been doing, with a similar population, just doing significantly better than Ohio in terms of population. So anyway, just a pretty interesting perspective there on what Rwanda's doing. And, even given, lack of resources, they've really made it work and done a great job. Next slide, Lindsay. So looking at our case count, again, this is just the epi curve that we discuss each week. I broke it down and I just went back a month rather than looking at the whole picture, because really we're seeing a sort of a different phase more recently. So again, right after 4th of July, we saw a peak. We had two consecutive days of 8 cases reported in Pitkin County residents. And then it's been pretty steady since then. We've been getting about 2 to 3 cases on average since that 4th of July weekend. We had another peak on the 3rd. We had 8 cases reported to us on Monday, and then a few cases just since then. I'd say for the most part, pretty consistent. We haven't reached over 8 cases since the beginning of July. We've been able to really maintain our case investigation and contact tracing protocol and getting all those done within 24 to 48 hours. Next slide. So what I want to focus on is, rather than just going through a bunch of data on national and state numbers, I want to pull out 3 themes that we've noticed here in our Pitkin County data that I think are useful and important to discuss. So the first one here is looking at the proportion of cases in Pitkin County that are among individuals in the Hispanic and Latinx community. And so, first of all, if we look at just the total percentage of individuals in Pitkin County that identify as Hispanic or Latinx, it's about 10.5% according to census data. So if you look back at March, it made sense, right? About 10% of the individuals testing positive were identifying as Hispanic or Latinx. So that's what we'd expect to see. Now, as we move into April and May, it stayed pretty consistent. But once we hit June and now into July and August, we're seeing a very disproportionate number of individuals in the Hispanic and Latinx community testing positive for COVID. The line there, the pink line, is a trend. And so we're really seeing a trend upward over from month to month, and seeing that these individuals are testing positive at much higher rates than other ethnicities. So this is something that we've been trying to highlight and really been looking at and trying to understand better. So education and trying to make sure that the information that we're putting out is not just in English, that's in Spanish as well, but also just understanding that these individuals tend, from what we found, to tend to work in more high-risk settings. So trying to understand the impact of trying to have an essential workforce, but while also trying to protect them as well from this virus. So this is something that we've been looking pretty closely at and we'll continue to look at and want to continue to provide education information on. Next slide. So the second theme here is out-of-town cases. We've received a lot of requests about out-of-town cases. And so we started compiling this data a little bit more carefully starting on July 11th. And so this image here, the pie chart, shows you the percent of cases that are testing positive here in Pitkin County, but belong to a different jurisdiction. So 43% of individuals that don't live in the area but tested positive here live in a different Colorado county. Majority of those are Garfield and Eagle. We have a handful that are elsewhere. Looking at out of state, Texas remains our number one in terms of individuals testing positive here from different state, followed by Florida and then California. And then we just had a handful from Michigan, Wyoming, Georgia, and New York. So we are still seeing that impact in individuals who are coming here from other states and are testing positive here. We still follow up with all these individuals. We don't just send out their cases immediately to the other state. We follow up with them, we get their information, we find out who they may have been around, where they were, where they stayed, all of that before we send it out. But we are still seeing an impact here from out of town individuals. And then looking at average age, there's a difference in age. So we tend to see that those who are traveling here tend to be younger than the population that's being infected here in Pickens County. Next slide. So then the final theme that I'll discuss, Kurt's going to discuss one in a bit, but the final thing I'll discuss is exposure source. So these are where individuals were actually infected. And as we've been talking about for the past few weeks, we have pretty high community spread. And again, community spread is the percentage of individuals who don't know where they were exposed. And so we're at 40%. And we've been at 40% pretty consistently for a while. I pulled data from July 1st up until today. And so that data is also consistent with that 40% community spread. So that means that we have a significant amount of individuals out there that we're unaware of. We don't know if we just missed them, if they didn't get tested, if they live in a different community, but there's 40% of individuals are claiming exposure to someone that we don't have record of. The next highest number on here is household contacts, which we expect to see. We know that the risk is higher among household contacts. So 27% of our cases since July 1st were infected by a household member. And then just a few other ones to know, informal gatherings, at Pickens County, we decided to limit informal gathering size to 10, and that's because we began to see an increase in individuals who were gathering informally. And since we put that in, we've seen a little bit less of that, but we've still been seeing quite a bit of exposure from informal gatherings. And then just a smattering of other ways in which people have been infected. Bus and carpool has been one that we've seen a few cases in. And then non-household and friends as well. So I think the key here and the point to take away from this is that, you know, there are still a significant amount of individuals out there who are around people that are exposing them and they're unaware of it. And so it's that reminder to us that, you know, regardless of where we are, there's always risk. It might be low risk, it might be medium risk, but there's always risk while we're out and about. Even in a city that only has seen 182 cases, there is still that risk out there. Next slide, Lindsay. And then I'm going to have Suzuho come in and discuss the coronameter.
Yeah, so we just wanted to let you all know that tomorrow we are going to have the coronameter go live on our website by the end of tomorrow. So we just want to thank you all for your input on getting this launched. I know there's been a lot of interest from the community for us to present this. So we just want to give you a quick overview of what you'll see at the top of the screen. When you go to that landing page tomorrow, there'll be a link on our website where you can go to the coronameter. You'll see this image there, and then a needle pointing to where we are across these four different phases between comfortable, cautious, concerned, and then very high risk. And where the needle lands is going to be based on a variety of metrics. Excuse me. Some of these metrics will be publicly displayed on this website and will be automated every day by 6 o'clock each day. We'll have that updated based on our new case counts and other indicators for that day. There's going to be a lot of other metrics that our team is also considering as we determine where to manually move the needle to, and we'll be sure to communicate with key partners and with the public as well when we are transitioning, as we've tried to do thus far as well. So in regards to the different indicators you'll see listed there, there's three different categories. The first is around disease spread. Some of the sample indicators that you'll see there include case counts for the last 14-day period, as well as percent of cases that might be travel related, and then new cases in our neighboring counties at Garfield and Eagle. The hospital capacity is one that we already have on our dashboard right now, so that will be the same and remain there on our coronameter. And then the third kind of matrix of indicators that we'll have is around disease control. So this will include PCR positivity rate, whether or not percentage of cases where we're able to conduct the interviews within 24 hours, symptom onset to testing time frames, and things like that. So again, you'll see all of those indicators listed lower on the website, but we're really excited to have this launching tomorrow. So huge thanks to all of our critical partners with the BITS and communications team within the county, and also media partners who offer to have this coronameter image on their website or newspapers and other opportunities to get this information out into the community as well. And then within our team, Kara, Josh, and Justine have been integral in making this happen. So just wanted to give you all an update on where we were with that, and we will have that live by the end of tomorrow. Thanks, Josh.
Thanks, Izuho. So I'm going to pass it off to Dr. Levin. She's going to discuss some of the hospital data.
Thank you, Josh and Izuho. Actually, it's on the same PowerPoint. If Lindsay, if you wouldn't mind continuing, I think my slide might be right there. Great. Okay, yeah, thank you so much. The coronameter is really exciting. And I remember when we first started talking about the idea, now it's being born. And so thank you, Izuho, and everyone for so much work on that. I really believe that that is going to be a critical way to communicate with the community in a very easy way for everyone in the community to have an idea of what's going on. And I also just wanted to say a quick word that I've enjoyed so much working with Charlie, and also he will be missed. And I am so looking forward to working with Josh going forward, and have already done quite a bit of work with him. So I appreciate that introduction about Charlie. Okay, so here's the hospital AVH matrix. Again, this is just one piece of the coronameter, but we are in comfortable in all three positions right now. So the inpatient hospitalizations, the average daily visits, and the essential healthcare workers. And this went to comfortable last week when Dave Ressler, the CEO, had discussed that at the community meeting last week. And so he'll, next slide, please. Here's the data that's looking at the matrix. You can do the next slide. Oh, great, thanks. Okay, so and I'm gonna actually move through these pretty quickly. So the inpatient totals, these are the totals, and it's going back from March all the way to present. And as you can see, we've been between one and two in terms of inpatient hospitalizations, patients who are admitted to the hospital. We're currently at zero. We've been at zero for the past 4 days. And as you can see, since the beginning of June, we've been in a good position in terms of inpatient hospitalizations, either zero to one. I do want to mention that we have transferred a total of 7 people to date, and that was 4 from the emergency department and 3 from an inpatient. The last one was July 6th that we transferred. So those are the patients that are even have a higher disease severity than we're able to take care of here, and typically either intubated or very high disease. So there's been a total of 7. Next slide, please. This is the emergency department patients with COVID-like symptoms. And it's you can see the trend when we were in lockdown in April and May, that it was very low. And for our matrix, the cutoff point is 6 per day. And so over the past month, you can see that we've gone over that for the first time since March, since early March, and that was in mid-July. We went above that, and now it looks like the trend is going down, which is in a promising direction. Next slide. And this is daily community COVID testing. As you all know, we were in the cautious phase for a while due to this on the matrix in July, which we are now for our 14-day average just below the 16 cutoff. And so we did spike above. Now we are just below. And so we're kind of on the brink. And so it's reassuring to know that we've gone below as an average of 16, but we're kind of just right on that brink. So we'll see what's to come. And hopefully this testing will continue to go downward. Next slide, please. And then this is the third parameter, the employees with COVID-like symptoms. We're down well below now the 6 essential healthcare workers. That is the cutoff. We're either at 1 or 2 at the moment. Next slide. I think this is an interesting slide. So this is all testing that we've done. This is for inpatient, which is IP, the emergency department, respiratory evaluation center, and asymptomatic testing done at AVH. And so we really see that we had a continual upward trend since we started testing at the end of April. And we peaked really right in like the third week in July. And since then, we've had this downward trend, which maybe Josh and I were talking about this, and maybe due to just a lower volume of visitors coming to town. It may be due to this Tri-County agreement to really focus on testing symptomatic patients only. So there may have been a lower number of asymptomatic testing being done. And if you look at the next slide, this is just asymptomatic testing. And again, I share the slide just as a reminder that there are asymptomatic cases. And so these are people who come for pre-op or pre-OB and routinely are getting tested just as they are going into the operating room as a precautionary measure. And so we saw in the beginning of July, kind of a peak of 10. Now we're seeing that it's going down. I just think it's interesting that we, again, this trend that we are testing fewer, but again, that it is present and it's in our community. Asymptomatic cases and spread are in our community. Next slide. This is just an interesting slide that we look at the antibody test results. And really, now that we know more and more about it, there was a spike in use in June and a little bit before. But now we're really not doing a lot of this testing as we understand that the test itself doesn't give a lot of guidance. We don't understand the immunity very well yet from this disease. And so the antibody testing volume has gone down significantly. Which again, it doesn't really help guide us much in our public health efforts. Next slide. And this is the positivity rate. You can see that it's kind of gone up and down since the end of June, stayed kind of at a higher level. Recently, since last week, it has gone up from 6.63% to 8.15%. However, the total positives, 15 and then now 22 in the last week. I think the positivity rate may just kind of do this wavy thing at this point. And again, we saw that there's a decrease in total volume of testing. And so that might be part of why the rate has gone up because the total number has gone down. Again, we'll keep looking at that. Next slide, please. This is just a slide looking at the number of outbreaks. I thought it was interesting that Josh provided. There's 12. Total outbreaks in Pickens County, and I know Kurt can probably speak more to this, but 7 of them with Pickens County residents. So, you know, just showing evidence that there's local outbreaks and there's additional information here about businesses and businesses contacted. Next slide. And this I just thought was interesting to show, and they'll go through more data with this, but, you know, the AVH data and the AVH capacity in the middle there. We are on the low. However, we are only one of 10 variables now that are being looked at that kind of give a bigger picture in this coronameter picture, which I think is so important that you can see that we're in the high range for community spread. We're at about 40%, the very high on 3 levels. And so it's just the AVH data is important and the hospital capacity is critical in terms of the sense of urgency, but just because we're at low doesn't mean that the bigger picture that there's other variables up there. And so I just wanted to show this quickly so that everyone gets a sense of how complex it is and what goes into the coronameter. Next slide. Just a quick update from the last time we met. I don't think I mentioned this last time, but the CDC has put out new guidelines that I thought was important for everybody to know about. And these new guidelines, I just put in bold what the differences are. So from before, most people who have COVID-like illness, the isolation period is 10 days after symptom onset, and that is the same. So that has not changed at all. And resolution of fever for at least 24 hours. And that was changed from 72 hours down to 24 hours. That's one difference. And another important difference here is that there are a limited number of persons with severe illness and some people with immunocompromised illness and states that extending the duration of isolation precautions may happen up to 20 days after symptom onset. This is a critical difference. Looking at and acknowledging that there are some people that actually may shed the virus beyond 10 days of the isolation guidelines. And so in the contact tracing and isolation and quarantine procedures, this will be looked at, and it may be a little difficult and complex to identify some of these people, but there may be some people who have isolation up to 20 days now. And then again, if you do not develop symptoms, but you have a positive test, so you're asymptomatic and test positive, your isolation period is for 10 days after the date of the positive test. Next slide. And that's it for me. I just wanted to mention one more thing, that even though the AVH matrix is on low and in a comfortable phase, it is the utmost timing to be cautious and really maintain our diligence with the five commitments. I applaud the Aspen City Council for passing a mask zone, and that seems to be working really well. And, you know, community spread is up at 40%. And I think it's really important now more than ever as we move into the fall to really, really be diligent and kind of decrease community transmission and give a good platform for schools to be able to open based on that. They will have their decision making based on community spread and the risk. And so it's really up to all of us to be as diligent as possible. Thank you. That's it.
Okay, thank you very much, Kim. Do we have any data from Eagle and Garfield County? I just saw that one little slide over there on the corona meter matrix that Kim just showed. Looked like that's pretty high. Karen, your thoughts?
Yeah, so Josh, do you want to just bring up, we can bring up the community spread or the data that we're tracking from Eagle and Garfield, if you want to pitch in there, if you want to bring up your slide on that.
Yeah, I think if you go back one or two slides, Lindsay. Yeah, we'll go one more forward to the trigger data. So here, where it says new cases in Garfield and Eagle. So what we're doing is we're tracking how many cases they've seen over the last 14 days, and we're combining them together. So if combined, they have seen over 75 cases in the past 14 days, we're considering that high, and that's what they're considering high as well. So we took their metrics, we put them together into ours to try to determine where they're at. And so they're both seeing very high levels of transmission. I can't remember the exact numbers from each community, but they are both in that very high range.
I think that's an important number that we keep in mind as we get into some discussion in terms of next strategies for our community. And just to inform the board, on Monday evening, Snowmass Town Council will be moving forward with a mandatory mask zones in the three nodes. So it'll be a special ordinance, and we have support from members of the Snowmass Village Town Council. So, Tori, we're joining the ranks. We see what you've done, and it's been very good, and we've got to keep the pedal to the metal in our community as well.
Got a question, Marky?
Yes.
About the percent of travel-related cases, what exactly does that mean? Travel-related cases, what kind of travel?
So these are individuals that they're not from Pickens County. So they are here for less than 1 month. We consider all those travel-related.
So their method of travel is not important. They could come in via airplane, they could drive in, et cetera.
Right, we haven't differentiated that out. That's correct.
Tori?
Thanks. Josh, I had a quick question for you about the 40% of community spread cases. Are there other details about that we are learning anything from? For example, the community spread cases, is there an age demographic that's associated with them? Are there any other insightful facts that we can gain from those cases?
Yeah, thanks. That's a good question. So in terms of age, no. The age is about the same between individuals who are infected via community spread and those who are not. The one thing that we have noted, and it's more anecdotal at this point, but they tend to be more mobile, right? So they tend to be more active. They tend to be hiking or out and about shopping a little bit more frequently than others, maybe taking the bus. So we have noted that. It's hard to quantify, but they do seem to be more active than those who have a known exposure.
Thank you.
Josh and team, there was an article in the San Francisco Chronicle this morning. Maybe it was yesterday, I don't remember when. And it has a statistic for every county in the United States for social gathering of 25 people, and what percentage within your community could get infected if 25, at least one person would get infected in a group of 25 or more, or 25. And in hovering over Picken County, it was like 79%. So Josh, I'm sure you probably did see that.
I did see that, yeah. You know, and I think that number makes sense, you know, given that we do have a high percentage of community spread, it makes sense that if you get together in a group of that size, that you would expect at least one of them to be positive for COVID.
I found that really interesting, and looking at Garfield and looking at Eagle, they're way up there in the 90%. So very interesting information. So with that said, Karen, did you want to introduce the next topic?
Sure. Lindsay, if you could go ahead and bring up the slides again. Thank you. So we had mentioned in the last Board of Health meeting that part of our strategy for the next 2 to 4 weeks was really to hone in on a mitigation plan. So thinking about how we can drive some of the numbers down and have some build out that we've been doing around other mitigation strategies that are in place beyond just the public health order. And we wanted to give you an update on where we are to date with that mitigation plan. And so each team is going to share a little bit with you about the work that they've been doing over the last two or so weeks. And so one of the teams is just the strategy and planning team. That's the team that I lead up, and you all are very familiar with these pandemic goals. I'm not going to go through them with you, but just to remind you and the viewing public that these are the ultimate goals that we're shooting for and toward, and they're pretty broad-based, but these are the things that we recognize need to be done to really address the transmission of SARS-CoV-2 through the community, as well as some long-range goals that we have on our horizon, such as what are we going to do when we get a vaccine, which sounds like it's happening faster maybe than when we originally thought, which is super heartwarming for me. But that alone is a lot of work to plan and prep for, knowing that there will be mass vaccinations in our community at some point. So there's some short-term things, and then there's some long-term visioning and thinking and planning around some of these goals. Next slide. So really the overarching point of this team is to think about strategies, what are the goals for the long-term strategy, and then to plan toward. And so this mitigation plan is a plan for and toward. So we're trying to really affect change on a super fast level around our numbers, and then think about other plans that we need to have in place to be able to manage the pandemic long-term. Next slide. So if you recall, when we shared the mitigation plan with you a few weeks ago, one of our goals was to, within 2 to 4 weeks, drive down our case counts. And actually in 14 days, we have been successful with that. Since on 8/5, we actually had 36 cases. We met that goal. So it's not the end all be all goal, but it's really great to know that things that we're doing in the community and the community's response, it's all of us together, are really helping to mitigate against the transmission of the virus. The long-term goals are still our long-term goals, really thinking about how do we get to schools in the best operating model. As Kim talked about, you know, community spread is directly linked to how schools can operate. And so what we do as individuals makes a difference in what the schools are able to do. That we really want to look at a safer winter tourism industry. And again, as I mentioned, a mass vaccination plan, knowing that that might be a 2021 kind of goal. So there are different things that we've been working toward As you all voted 2 weeks ago to revise the public health order, we're not bringing anything to you all today to look at on a policy decision-making basis, but some of those things, as Josh alluded to, we reduced group size. We're starting to see a little bit less transmission informally, and so hopefully that strategy is actually being effective. And we'll talk a little bit about the community liaison program that Jordana oversees, the consumer employee health protection program that Brian's been building out, our communication and marketing strategies that we've been building out, the Box It In strategy, the disease investigation and control program building out, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the regional coordination that we've been doing with Garfield and Eagle. Next slide. So those regional and statewide strategies have really been where I've been putting a lot of my effort to work with Eagle and Garfield County on a shared testing strategy, a regional testing strategy. And Kim alluded to this as well. It's testing for a purpose. So we're looking at symptomatic folks getting first priority, close contacts to those folks, and people that are at high risk to having a close contact. And so testing for a purpose is really important right now because we are still seeing slow turnaround times with labs. If the turnaround time is so slow, our other Box It In corners do not work. We cannot do effective isolation, contact tracing, and quarantine if the test turnaround time is so low. And so we're really trying to think about different ways we can work at a regional level to increase that ability to increase test turnaround times, knowing that we don't have a lot of control over that. It's really up to labs and lab capacity. The state is really focused on this right now. The governor has given a mandate that no stone should be left unturned in looking at other kinds of ways to increase lab capacity. So that's working with universities and others to increase places where test results can be, or test samples can be sent. So it's not necessarily the throughput of people getting access to testing, but it really is around the lab capacity right now. So that's what we're working on regionally. We're also working on a shared mitigation strategies with Eagle and Garfield, and that includes a shared communication strategy that all three counties are working toward collectively, so we have shared messages for our communities, knowing that there are visitors and locals that are traveling throughout each community. And then we are also looking at some shared other mitigation strategies. So that is in collaboration. We talk weekly. We're looking at a regional epidemiological team that would serve just the Roaring Fork Valley, made up of all three county members of all three counties, so that we can have better communication when we have a case investigation, where maybe the person that is infected with COVID-19 may be a resident of Eagle County, but the business is located in Pitkin County, and that creates some struggles with communication around that. So a regional team would really help to mitigate against that. We're also looking at funding, because this is a real big struggle for us as we started to staff up, as well as just needing the resources to be able to do this work. It is super intensive work, and in order to really do an effective mitigation plan, we have to have the resources to support that. So we've been looking at seeking out additional funding to increase our own capacity to do this work. Next slide. So I'm going to turn it over, and we'll pause there, see if there's any questions about the overarching strategy. Some of our, again, these are immediate things that we're trying to address right now in the mitigation plan around strategy and planning.
Does anyone have any questions or comments for Karen? Yeah, Tori.
Thanks. Karen, and I don't know that this is the right time for these kind of questions, but, you know, I'm wondering about, you know, we've gotten a lot more data, we've gotten a lot more information. We seem to be, in some ways, you know, tightening our grip and getting some containment. And I'm just worrying about, what do next steps look like? Low level transmission that we're going to settle in with, or are there next measures? And the things that I am thinking of is, for example, the screening, and whether that's not testing or not even thermometer screening, but just asking our guests those vital questions. Have you been around anybody that's had COVID? Have you been symptom free for 10 days? Checking people into their hotels and having the hotels. Are we looking at next measures as you talk about these mitigation plans? Are we looking at next measures? And I'm just wondering, do we have any thoughts about next measures? Are there next measures and the like? But just wondering if, and this might not be the time for that kind of answer. Maybe that's a bigger question than right now, but just wondering.
I'm hoping, Tori, that as we go through the presentation, you'll start to get some answers to that. But yeah, we really wanted to hone in on this 2 to 4 week, very kind of structured piece of let's see which different, and if you remember, the mitigation plan had a lot of different strategies. We're not going through all of them today. We're just sort of highlighting a few, but there are multiple strategies that we have in place that we really wanted to hone in on, put a lot of energy and effort into, and see how the results of that, and then to think about some of these longer term pieces. And I think as far as, you know, I Josh, I'll go back to him, but I still think we're in this yellow, we are in this yellow zone. So, and maybe a little bit tipping a little bit closer to the, not to the orange, but more to the orange than to the blue. And so we want to drive down to the blue, right? That's where we want to be as a community. I honestly think that we are doing, they're cautiously optimistic on some pieces, not to say we shouldn't be keeping track of this and on top of it. But when we look at our neighboring communities, and it's all relative, right? So are we doing well? I think the community is doing good. We could do better. and then when we look, you know, if we compare Colorado to other states, or we compare Colorado to British Columbia, we're actually not doing that well as a state. So, you know, it's all relative. Like, yes, we're doing better than Texas. Are we doing better than Maine? No. So we want to, you know, I think ideally we want to be in that blue zone across the state. We'd like to be in the blue zone in this community. Josh, anything to add to that?
No, I don't think so. You know, I think we're averaging about 3 cases per day right now. So if we can get that down to about 1.5 to 2, that's, I think that'd be a more comfortable place to be.
Brent?
Yeah, I'd just like to add on what Tori said. I'm interested in next steps too, whether it may be involving the airport, as I sent a message to Karen about, but involving the airport as a screening hold. And then also this business of regional sharing of information. I think that's a great idea. And I think that we in the future ought to have some device, much like Interpol, which shares police data throughout the EU. We should have some sort of structure so that, and I'm sure they do at the CDC, but there's no reason we can't have a localized operation like that, getting a real-time picture of just what's happening and where. Anyway, I think it's a good idea.
Thank you, Brent. Karen?
Great. I'm going to turn it over. And again, if you feel like your questions aren't getting answered as we go through this, please hold them and we'll address them in the round robin. And we do have some airport information to share with you during the round robin as well. So Jordana, are you the next? Sorry, forget who's next.
Okay. Thanks for pulling up those slides, Lindsay. So I'm going to talk through today a little bit more about the community liaison team. And the goal of our program in that team is really to reduce transmission of COVID-19 in the community by developing and communicating and updating this guidance that addresses the operations of specific sectors throughout the community. So what this team really does to try to achieve that goal is to comb through the requirements and recommendations that are out there, best practices that exist, see what research is out there and developing, and be able to create requirements and recommendations for all of these different sectors on how to operate in order to really reduce that transmission of COVID. So the ways that we can implement this guidance are through either our public health order. So for example, more of the broad strokes are kind of implemented through the public health order. For example, the gathering sizes or the requirement that every business must have a safety plan, things like that. And then the more specific guidance as to exactly what these, the details of ins and outs of how to meet those requirements from the public health order in each sector are really more detailed and available on the website. So I think one unique thing or great thing that we did in response to this event was to require these business and then later event safety plans to be completed by any business that is operating right now or organization, and then also anyone who's holding an event that is over 10 people, under 50 people, and that's being held by a formal event planner, a professional event planner. They're required to fill out a business or event safety plan, which are available on the website. And what this really does is it makes sure that those that are responsible are reviewing the guidance related to their sector and determining how are they going to comply, what does this look like in my setting, and then being able to communicate it with their staff and their patrons. So the other thing I really wanted to share is that, you know, we know that things are changing all the time, and how are we continuing to update this guidance and make it as good as it can be, as relevant as it can be, as updated as it can be. And we do that in a couple of different ways. So we are able to update the guidance based on the changing level of risk. The example of gathering size was a great example. So when we saw that we needed to make a change there, we changed the public health order and then all of the resulting guidance, communicated that out to the community and all of the partners as to what that looks like now, and developed any new processes that needed to be developed. We also continue to update the guidance based on any changes in state guidance, as Kim just shared, any changes in CDC guidance, that all comes back to this team to make sure that we're sharing the most updated information. Another really important part of what this team does is uses feedbacks from local partners. So we've really got a way to go out and look at those sectors that are being affected. And if we're developing new guidance or updating guidance, really wanting to hear from the folks who are trying to put this into practice as to what's going well, what may be some of the challenges, and how can the guidance be more clear, any changes that we can make to help always go back to that goal of reduce that transmission to COVID-19. The other things that help come back into our feedback cycle are observations from the consumer protection team, who are out there in the field visiting with businesses and seeing how well they're implementing the guidance, as well as information from the case investigation team about where cases are coming from, if we know anything about how spread is happening and if we can address that, and then as well as emerging research. We know all of this is changing day by day. Larissa, sorry, Lindsay, could you advance the slide, please? So our community liaison team is really made up of a couple different teams within the response. One is this business liaison. So Bob Schultz, who's been with us since the beginning, does a fantastic job, especially of reaching out to folks in the community to hear how things are going, and be able to make those connections and bring that back to the team to inform the guidance. Public health subject matter experts, Larissa, who was hired and just started on July 13th, as well as our new hire, Tiffany Greenlee, who will be starting on the 19th of August, are the subject matter experts who are really lending a lot of capacity to that team and our ability to research, our ability to develop guidance and keep it updated. We have a member of the consumer and employee protection team. So those are the folks who are going out in the field, and Brian will talk about that later, exactly what they're doing, but they're a member of this team, bringing what they see and how we can continue to improve the guidance there, as well as members from our communications team. Because what good is guidance if people don't know about it? So they're really the ones who are able to get it out through a variety of more broad-based channels, as opposed to either the relational or the specific business email channels that we currently have. Next slide, please. And so I thought I would walk you through just one example of what we've been doing this week. And this is really gives you an example into how we develop guidance. So it came up as the need was identified by the case investigation team. As you saw in an earlier slide, we're seeing that a common exposure point, or we're tracing back some of these COVID-19 cases to carpooling or shuttles. We also know that this is an area where Garfield County has noted that a lot of exposure is happening. And so we looked back at our team and said, well, what can we do to help? And realized that we don't have specific guidance for taxis, limos, shuttles, and ride shares. And we could greatly improve and promote the carpooling guidance that's available to folks. So this week we've really spent developing that guidance, going out and looking for the best guidance that's out there, looking at the CDC, and actually Toronto, Canada had some of the best protocols that we've seen. So we've taken those, we've had discussions within our team, decided they really needed to be two different kinds of guidance. Bob, again, our business liaison, has been reaching out to hotels that have shuttles. He's reached out to taxi companies. He's reaching out to other organizations that use van pools. And showing them our draft guidance and saying, you know, how does this look to you? Does this seem like that would work? What are any kind of, pinch points that you can imagine so that we can address that before we finalize the guidance? And so our goal is that next week we're going to be able to have this guidance finalized and then be able to communicate it through all of those channels, through our communications team and their work with putting out that weekly newsletter. Maybe we can get some radio spots to run during high travel times, sector-specific information. So anyone who submitted a business safety plan indicates what sector they're with, as well as who that contact is. So we can really target this communication. And then Bob's work right now of that relational work with the different sectors. Some fun facts. We've developed 16 guidances specifically over the past couple months. And then this team also works on drafting those public health orders and addendums. And we are up to 12 versions since the middle of March. And I think Brian is next.
Thanks, Jordana. So yeah, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the consumer and employee health program. So my team is going around to the businesses and being out in the field and looking to see if people are able to follow these rules that we've put forth in the guidance and in the public health orders. So the main things that we are focusing on currently is making sure that all operating businesses have submitted their COVID-19 business safety plan and that they are following the guidance that pertains to their industry, whether that be a gym or a restaurant or a construction site or everything in between. We work really closely with Jordana's team to make sure that these guidelines make sense and they work for the industry. And it's making sure that they can operate safely based on the requirements that we put forward. Another portion of our job is responding to complaints. We're trying to do that as fast as possible. It generally is about 24 to 48 hours to investigate a complaint. And we feel that's really important so we can see issues in the community and correct them before they become problems. And then hopefully we don't have to go through a lot of enforcement actions, but we do have that ability if required, if businesses after our visits to try to make sure they understand compliance and how they're supposed to operate. If they refuse to operate under those conditions, we can go down an enforcement road to stop them from operating dangerously and possibly being a spreading event of COVID-19. So we can just change slides. All right. So my county team is me as the manager of this team. And then we got Tucker on our team starting about 3 weeks ago and Joanna about 5 weeks ago. So our team is now fully staffed and fully trained and able to go out into the field, and they're conducting routine visits throughout the county. We have conducted visits in Snowmass, Aspen, Basalt, and Redstone so far. Our goal is to get to every business in the county and talk with them to make sure that they understand what guidelines that they're required to do and the basic requirements of what's in the business safety plan as far as checking temperatures when you are entering work, that you're wearing a mask if you are not in a private office, secluded by yourself, and lots of other things, sanitization and social distancing, but lots of different criteria. The City of Aspen's team currently is being run by CJ Oliver and Natalie Sevdos. They kind of have a temporary team that has been Mitch, Linda, and Lara that have been able to get around to these businesses pretty well throughout the city and respond to complaints. And then finally, the City of Aspen Police, they have been putting in a lot of work, especially with this new mask ordinance and doing a lot of the late night checkups for bars and that sort of thing that are kind of out of our timeframes and out of our abilities. So that's, we're really blessed to be able to have them being able to do that for us as well. So like I said, these are the three focuses that we are focusing on right now is this business outreach, making sure that everybody has these business safety plans so they understand the requirements that they are held to when they're operating their business. In the first few weeks of this, we did see a lot of non-compliance with not having business license or business safety plans. So we felt that was a really important thing to do to contact all these businesses and make sure they understand that these are the requirements. And if they have any questions, to let us know. But this is what we expect you guys to do to be able to operate. And the other two things being the business visits, whether that's in relation to a complaint that we are investigating or just a regular visit. We, like I said, we're trying to visit every business in the county to ensure that they're not only complying with the orders, but understand them and that they're able to do that safely and consistently and not just when we walk in the door. And then in the future, we're still working on this, but we are working towards being able to review these COVID event safety plans because we've seen that these events have been, I guess it's 9% recently of our cases of their spreading coming from events, informal or otherwise. So we just want to make sure that when people are submitting these event safety plans that they meet the criteria that they're supposed to be held to, that they're not going to be having cocktail parties and out walking around. If they're going to be serving food, it has to be just like how a restaurant operates, that tables are set more than 6 feet apart and that no more than 8 people at their table, and that if they get up from their table to go socialize with others at the event, that they need to be wearing a mask. So that's what we're looking to start doing that soon. So hopefully next week we'll have a plan for that. If you want to switch slides. So here's just some data that I put together for what we've seen recently. So in relation to this, looking for these business safety plans, my team has been sending out a lot of emails to specific businesses to contact them and make sure they understand that this is a requirement and they need to get their business plan submitted ASAP. We also worked with ACRA and GoSnowMass, SNOMASS's tourism department, to contact local businesses as well. And we feel like we've had pretty good success. Since July 14th, we've seen 91 plans come in, and we're continuing to chase these down as we see that people haven't responded to our emails after a few days. We're making phone calls and reminding businesses that this is a requirement, and if we don't get responses, then we're then working on going to site visits and doing that in person, which then can end up in follow-ups and things that could end up in enforcement actions if they continue to not follow the rules as required. So we've visited 40 businesses so far, whether they be routine visits or complaint investigations. Most of the businesses we see are doing really well. They're trying to follow the guidance as best they can. We're seeing good signage and good mask usage, and definitely reminding patrons as they're walking into the businesses that they need to be wearing masks. Initially, that seemed to be a bit of a challenge, but I think people are getting that message. And as far as the patrons, that this is a requirement for our county, and you shouldn't expect to be able to go into any business at all without a mask. And I think that is now pretty standard and expected. So I don't think we're having big issues with that anymore. We're also seeing really good businesses doing their symptom checks and all these important things to make sure that their employees aren't sick when they're working, which is another way to protect our tourist industry and our locals being able to shop in our stores. Another big part of when we're out at these businesses is just clearing up misunderstandings with the guidance and the public health orders. There's just been so many changes and so many public health orders from the state and from the county, and what you see on the local news and state news and everything in between, to just make sure that they're really clear as far as understanding what they're supposed to be doing. And I think the guidance that they've been putting together has been really great and helpful. And when we see things that may not be clear to the businesses, we're trying to get those amended. So it's really easy for them to see that. So we've investigated 32 complaints in Pickens County in the past 2 weeks. That's about on par with what we saw 2 weeks prior. And then I broke down those 32 complaints into different categories. So most of the complaints that we're seeing are things that are not really violations of, like, somebody riding a bike on a road without a mask on, or somebody hiking on a trail without a mask on, things like that. We are seeing still significant amount of restaurants and gym complaints, mostly about mask usage. And then also events. So we have seen people complaining about large size events, about people not wearing masks at events, kind of everything in between. And this also kind of pushed us towards wanting to do those reviews of these events. And then I just want to mention the city of Aspen and what they've been doing. So they have visited 91 businesses. They started a little earlier than us because they were starting before July 4th, essentially. And then based on this new mask zone, they've spent over 100 hours out in the field talking to people and reminding them of the mask zone requirements. And they've made over 2,000 contacts to individuals regarding these mask requirements. So they're really putting a big amount of effort out in the field and just reminding people out there that this is required. So I think we're doing really good, and we can continue to make progress on what we've already done. That's about all I have, I think.
Thank you, Brian. Any questions for Brian? I don't see any hands going up. Okay. Who's next, Karen?
I believe that Kurt.
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, Kurt, we can.
Okay, thank you, and apologies, my camera's not working. Apparently, there are more viruses going around. I have a computer virus, it seems, that seems to disable the functions of cameras on our computers sometimes. So anyway, I wanted to talk today about the disease prevention and control team. And I think you've heard a lot about our team. Most of you should be familiar with the box it in strategy that we've been talking about. And this team really owns three corners of the box it in, and even the fourth corner, testing. We're working with our other teams on testing. So you could really even say three and a half of the corners in the box it in strategy are the parts of the team that we're working on. So we're identifying sick people. And then we're looking to contain the disease and prevent illness by using isolation and quarantine. And you've heard those terms a number of times. Isolation is where we isolate people who are sick, who have been identified to have the illness. And then those people that have come in contact with somebody who is sick, we quarantine. These are tools that we use when we don't have medical intervention. They've been around for a very long time. Probably even pre-biblical, but certainly the modern interpretation started in the 14th century plague outbreaks that we're familiar with. So Kim talked a little bit about the changes that have happened with isolation requirements. Essentially for the general public, you started a 10-day isolation, and then there are conditions in which they would get released. 24 hours, no fever, and their symptoms have to be improving. And then if we have people who are either severely ill or work in the healthcare industry, those isolation conditions change. Quarantine is for people who came in contact with somebody sick. And we have definitions on less than 6 feet for them, more than 15 minutes is the standard definition. And people who are come in contact are required to quarantine for 14 days. And that's because the incubation period of the virus is between 2 and 14 days. So we go up to that last part, 14 days for quarantine. So we're really containing the disease by making sure it's not being spread. Once somebody is sick, we're trying to make sure that they're not coming in contact with others. And then because we know we have transmission either pre-symptomatic or asymptomatic, people who are have come in contact, we quarantine to make sure that we're capturing that aspect as well so they're not spreading the disease. The other important piece that our team is really doing, a lot of the data that you're seeing is really being collected through our team and then is being presented here. And we use that for not only decision-making, but again, Jordana talked a little bit about that cross-cutting piece with consumer protection and looking at, you know, are there pieces where as we interview a case, we're identifying maybe some behaviors at a business or something that then we can pass on to consumer protection to have them go investigate. The team itself, it's as you can expect, it's labor intensive. So we get information from what we call CDERS, which is the Colorado Electronic Disease Reporting System, or from AVH or from local providers directly in some cases. Our team takes that information and then they call the positive person. From there, we communicate the isolation requirements to make sure that they receive them, and then start talking about, you know, where they've been and who they might have come in contact with in the last couple of days. We look at 2 days prior to when they were symptomatic. And then we also talk about where they've been in the last 2 weeks to try to identify where they may have been exposed. And so that's some of the information we're looking for. In terms of staffing, We're fortunate now, we've probably had the full staff on board now for not quite 2 weeks. Back when this started in March, there were two of us that started doing this. It expanded out with the City of Aspen Environmental Health staff and then Community Health Services gracefully lent us some of their staff part-time to help with case investigation. And we recognized early on that that wasn't a sustainable method, so we got permission to hire. And then Lindsay, can you go to the next slide, please? And so this is the staff that we've hired out. Obviously, Josh, most of you know, he just presented earlier and has been presenting previously. And Sam and Jeanette are the two case investigation leads. And then they each have two people under them. Under Sam is Christella and David, who are case investigators. And under Jeanette, we have Berta and Andrew, who are also case investigators. And I can only say that, you know, in the 2 weeks that they've been on, it's been a real blessing, not only from a workload point of view, but I really have been impressed with the job that they have done and the outreach that this team has already done just in 2 weeks. So we've really seen the scope of the work that we've done, and the data that Josh is putting together really has just started to flourish, and we're able to do a much better job with getting information to the leadership team to help with decision making. Next slide. So one of the focus points that we wanted to talk about, and Josh and I talked about a couple, but we want to talk about turnaround time. And in this case, the graph that you're looking at is really looking at the time when the specimen's collected to when we receive the result to start our investigation. This was an issue we had early on. If some of you remember when we first started back in March, we had really long turnaround times, some of them in the 1.5 to 2 week period in some extreme cases. That slowly got better. Unfortunately, we're starting to see that tick up again. I think that's because the number of people that are getting tested, you know, as we've loosened the public health orders around the state, we've seen an increase in cases, and we've seen an increase in symptomatic persons. That's driven an increase in testing. It has slowed down several labs. Certainly CDPHE lab has had a lag of turnaround times. And as you can see in the data, the cumulative is 3.1, but in the last couple of days, in the last week really, we've gone up to about 5.2 days. And this is important to us because timing is a critical aspect of case investigation. The longer the information is delayed in getting to us, the more likely people are to have additional contacts and spread the disease. So the faster we get this data, the better we're going to be able to do our job. When you look at 5.2 days, really, you're just looking at more potential contacts for folks before they either know that they're positive. In theory, they should be isolating, but as we're doing case investigation, it's clear that that's a piece that's not getting relayed to the patient when they go to get tested. So when you get tested, you should go home and isolate until you hear what your results are. One of the areas that we've identified as a problem is this communication. It's not being consistent from what we can tell. So I think there are a couple of approaches that we need to look at, especially around this case investigation, turnaround time and the isolation. Education is probably the most important piece that we're looking at. You know, we have a Health Alert Network, which is also HAN for short. And we are going to release some information on HAN. That's a system that the CDC started probably back in the 80s and maybe even previous to that. But my knowledge is it started when fax systems came about. That was a way to discern medical information from the CDC to the state health department, and then from the state health department to locals. And then locals send that out to local providers in the hospital and other providers, you know, specifically targeted. Sometimes we send those to schools, even childcares even. But we'd like to utilize that system to provide some information to the providers, just to detail some of the issues we're seeing around, you know, assurance of turnaround time. We've worked with Aspen Valley Hospital when they do testing to go ahead and call our department when they have a positive result, so that we're not waiting on a lag time for it to get reported into the electronic system. We have providers, some providers doing that as well, but I think there's still some opportunity to make sure that all the providers are hearing that. So I think there's some education around that piece. There's also opportunities. Aspen Valley Hospital holds a provider meeting, as Kim reminded me, on the second Thursday of the month. I was gonna show up this evening and probably wouldn't have had anyone around. But we try to make sure we're participating in that to have a conversation with providers on. And so this will be one of the pieces that we bring up to talk through turnaround times, make sure everyone understands the importance and the couple opportunities that we do have and how they can report this information back to our department. And then the third thing we're doing is working with Quality Health Network, QHN. They're a medical record company that is out of Grand Junction that works with the providers and hospitals on the Western Slope. They're also getting information when we have positive results. And so we're working with them to see if there's a way we can speed up that reporting time to our department utilizing their services. And they are planning on having our first report generated August 30th. And so we'll see if that helps with this turnaround time too. And then the last piece is we're working with provider, or not providers, but our partners, including the state, around potential solutions to the turnaround time with backups and labs. So I know Aspen Valley Hospital is utilizing several labs, not necessarily the state lab because of the backup times, but the state is looking at expanding their lab capacity again to try to address their backup times. They're also looking at potentially courier services for the Western Slope that would utilize an airplane to transport the samples so that we're not doing it by ground, which will save us time. There's also talk about flying those samples instead of to the state lab in Denver, but to one of the labs in California that has capacity to get this turnaround time back to that 24 to 48 hour period, which is what we're really looking for. There's also some discussion about expanding out potentially to maybe even one of the local public health labs around the state for additional sample processing, or even one of the community colleges. So hopefully we can identify some of those solutions that'll help get this number back down to make sure that we're able to do our job. Any questions?
Any questions for Kurt? I'm glad that QHN is on board. That's great to know they're going to be a huge help to this effort. Any questions for Kurt? Okay. Next, is it Suzuho or is it Kara or whom, Karen?
I believe it's me. Yep, perfect. Thanks, Lindsay. So I'll talk a little bit about the dusting data testing and admin teams and what we're working on. So in regards to the data team, our main program goals include collecting and analyzing information. So this data could be coming from our case investigations and our contact tracing team. It could be coming from our consumer protection team and the business liaison teams that were mentioned earlier. Any kind of information that they're gathering, this is a new virus and a new field that we're all working within. So really trying to keep up with all of the information that all of our various teams are gathering and trying to make sense of what's going on in our community and really understand, get a better picture of what's going on so we can best align our strategies to address what is happening here. We take the information from those different teams to really help inform different strategies, illuminate where there might be differences or similarities across subpopulations. As Josh mentioned earlier in his presentation around the data, we are seeing some differences by race and ethnicity already and potentially from other demographic data that we're collecting as well. So those are things that we're really looking at from a health equity perspective and then wanting to ensure data integrity. So with a new team and new infrastructures that are being set up, our data team is really looking at all of these databases and metrics to make sure that there is quality assurance and quality improvement actions are taken when we notice any glitches in our systems and things like that. We also want to make sure that we're informing the community and our key decision makers about what's going on. So our data dashboard is one of those elements. We've had various community surveys where we've collected data as well. So making sure that such data is summarized and posted on our website. And then the new Corona meter is another element that we're adding in regards to our data reporting process. And then the testing team is really focusing right now in the box it in strategy as was shared. And we have Charlie who is continuing to lead or be one of the leads from our team for developing the regional strategy that's focusing on testing accessibility and capacity, as well as decreasing turnaround time, which has been brought up by Josh and Karen earlier, really ensuring the widespread availability of test and that results are coming back within a timely manner so we can continue that box it in strategy in an effective way. And then also evaluating new and existing test types that are coming out almost on a weekly basis, it seems like. So those are a few of the things that the testing team is working on. And then the admin team, we have Lindsay, who you all know, and then Raleigh, who we'll introduce at the next Board of Health meeting. But she just joined our team last week, and we're really excited to have her as the new admin assistant, specifically for our COVID response team. And so our team there has been growing as well and really is designed to support all of the various other teams in a cross-cutting way. Next slide, Lindsay. So in regards to the staff that we have on these teams, I'll read through some of these names. So everyone knows Charlie, who's our consulting epidemiologist now. Justine Shelley has been our data analyst, and she's another individual who reached out very early in the pandemic and was willing to jump right in. So really grateful for all of her support. We're gonna be transitioning that role and just have it posted again. So if any of you know someone who might be interested in a data analyst position, please check out our Pickens County job board, and it's posted there. Audrey, who some of you may have worked with, was an intern from the Colorado School of Public Health, CSU Fort Collins, and just finished her internship with us last week. And we may be bringing in some other interns in the future, but she was studying epidemiology and just provided a lot of support to our contact tracing team, especially during her time with us this summer. And then Lindsay, our administrative specialist, who started a few months ago, and then Raleigh, who I just mentioned as well. So our team, like the others, are also growing. I'm really grateful for the county and community support as we grow our teams to be able to better respond to this work. And in regards to our partners, there's a lot of folks that we're working with, but especially for the data elements, we really couldn't do all of the things that we're doing with our dashboard and coronameter without some critical partners. So really wanting to acknowledge all of their support, and we see them as kind of honorary members of our data team as well, even if they're not within the public health department. And then one area that we wanted to highlight in regards to the work that we're doing is the community survey. So as some of you might remember, early on we had a symptom tracker that was done for Pickens County, mirroring off of what Eagle County was doing. We also had an emotional check-in to really assess the mental health impacts and concerns within our community when the pandemic first started. And since then, we've really had a variety of community surveys roll out, trying to align them with each of our different public health orders to understand what community priorities are, what people are experiencing day to day, and what their perceptions are of the virus, as well as our response efforts. So we will have another community survey that's going to be highlighted in our newsletter tomorrow, along with the coronavirus. So we'll have that going out in English and in Spanish. So an opportunity for us to really hear from the community about what they're experiencing. And this information is really helpful for us to think about how we can align our resources and our strategies to the community needs. So as much as possible, just a quick pitch. If you all are able to fill out the community survey, it really helps us out to understand what's going on in the community and what you all are experiencing. And it could be filled out through the web link or on a mobile device. The link will be connected to our data dashboard as well as the newsletter. In regards to the process for these community surveys, we've really tried to integrate questions from impacted partners. So our previous survey had some questions from the mental health committee that they proposed. This time around, we've worked collaboratively with some of our staff members who are working with schools to integrate some questions related to schools reopening or their virtual options. In order to hear from everyone in our community, we also have these surveys available in English and Spanish, as I just mentioned. And then there's a few, those are the different ways that you can also access it through, instead of a press release, we're gonna put it in the newsletter only, but there's also a link to the data dashboard. And then in regards to the types of questions that will be integrated in the survey that's coming out tomorrow, here are a few different categories of questions that we have. The first is around perception and concern. Again, this really allows us to understand what's going on in the community and hear from all of you about what your thoughts are around the county's response strategies, likelihood of getting infected, or safety in returning to work or returning to school. We also have some questions around people's behaviors to understand how often you might be wearing face coverings and how often you are socializing with non-household members and how that may be different or is the same compared to pre-COVID days. We are also collecting demographic questions in all of our surveys as well as our intake forms, and this really is to help promote our values around health equity and to align our work with our values to make sure that we're looking at our data in a way that can help highlight any potential inequities that exist. So earlier, Josh mentioned that we have a higher rate of individuals who are Hispanic Latinx who receive positive test results for COVID compared to the percentage of Hispanic Latinx folks in our community. But we're still trying to get the actual denominators for that. It might be because they are testing more. It also might be because of the systemic racism that we know that Josh alluded to a little bit as well. We know that Hispanic Latinx folks tend to be in more of our service industries and things like that. So our data team is really trying to collect that demographic information so we can better understand where those nuances might be coming into play, better understand some of the systemic inequities that might be leading to some of these differences, and also help us understand our responsibility and if it's more around education and information sharing or accessibility to information, then we may need to work with our communications team to make sure that not only are materials translated in Spanish, but also provided in a mode of communication that fits the needs of every community. So similarly, we also have questions around gender and sexual orientation, knowing that there's a lot of LGBTQ plus folks who have experienced barriers to accessing healthcare services well beyond or well before COVID, and wanting to track some of those potential inequities, and then also employment status or what industries people work in to help us see if there are differences there as well. I think that's it for me, and I will turn it over to, is it Kara? I'm not sure who from the communications team is going next.
Is there any questions for Suzuho before Kara takes over? I will have a couple questions, but I'll wait till round robin for those, Suzuho. Okay, Kara.
And actually, I think Phyllis is going to take lead on this.
Sorry, Phyllis.
Hi, Phyllis.
Hi. Welcome. There. Well, we have Tracy Trulove, who is our lead, actually out taking her son to college this week. So we're all punting, Kara and I. So looking at our response and recovery goals, we want to provide information to the public that's accurate and timely, engage the public on complex topics around COVID, and then the coordination regionally, which Tracy has really been the point person on. And right now our priorities have been providing simple and easily repeatable vision that will ensure consistency among our partners regarding how do people take care of themselves, the five commitments, the three C's, and then the information that you've heard from all these team members, how to take the key messages that they need to be amplified in the community and how can we get it across. Right now, promoting how contact tracing works and is safe and confidential, when to seek testing and what the symptoms of coronavirus are. We found some confusion there. The coronameter is going to be a biggie, as well as our newsletter. And I thought it was kind of funny that we all forgot to put our website on here, which has become, it has more and more information every time we pick something up and realize we should be getting this information out. So that's been growing all along as this has started. Go on to the next slide. So some of the communication materials, it started out with branding early on. So we've been using the same graphic artist that started when the IMT was in action. So we've been trying to come up with some simple ways to get messages out. So these are the two new ones that we have. And you'll see on the bottom, it says, get your poster today. We have all of our communication materials listed on our website. So anyone can go there and print any of these materials out use them, post them for employees, post them on windows and office spaces. So how COVID-19 testing works. So we have Mike and Melissa going to a birthday party in Pitkin County, and then what happens when someone tests positive? And we make it kind of easy, the 14 days, the isolation. And then one that's a little more detailed on how it works regarding what happens if someone tests positive, someone their contacts could be positive or negative, and it goes into a little bit more detail. We're thinking these comic strip looking materials, maybe how we're going to tell some of these stories. We will have them in English and in Spanish, and so we're working on that. These two, I think, just got produced today. So we're pretty excited at just about the format and trying to make it a really easy message. And also so it can be in physicians' offices, because we're finding that physicians don't always know how contact tracing works. So how do they explain to the people that they're testing and what happens if they test positive? So go on to the next. So our team of people, I like that Kara made the slide for us. Thank you very much, Kara. So the fun fact that when the IMT was in operation, there were 12 full-time people that were devoted to communications. Currently, we have a team of 9, and only one of those people are full-time, and it's actually an employee that's on loan to us from the library. So we thank the library for that. So you'll see my name, and then Kara, our community liaison in public health strategy. Michaela Wiggins, who has been, well, she is our best and brightest intern. She started at the beginning of the year. She's on a grant that we have through the Department of Local Affairs, DOLA, and she has incredible energy. So it's great to have her. Audrey Bowman is now our social lead. So all of our Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter feeds, she's in charge of. Sandra Story helps her there. She's an employee from the library that we've recruited. Lindsay Douglas, who you'll see her name everywhere. She plays a lot of roles in this. I was gonna say wears a lot of hats, but she's on the wear a mask lead. And we now have it where people can submit their selfies or other pictures with them wearing a mask and why they wear a mask on our website. So people can do that. And we're hoping to use all these pictures that we have in some kind of promotion. Nick Calderon, he's our website designer and developer. He is a contractor, but he started from a recruitment we did through the Aspen Community Foundation looking for a volunteer to help us get a website up. And Nick answered us. So for the first couple months, April and May, he was a volunteer and built our website. We've since brought him on as a contractor because he's just been amazing. And Gina Sheldrake, so our graphic designer who did the comic strip and does all the did the template here for our PowerPoint. And then our newest ad is Rachel Brenneman, who's working with our Human Services Department on communications for them. So we're adding next will be the business liaison group who wants to add communications into their, I guess, their quiver of tools. So we're going to be adding them. We kind of look at it as a three-legged stool. We have all our public health information, our human service information, and then our business information. And they're really all linked together. And the more we can do making consistent communications between those three different buckets, we'll all be better off. And with a small team, being efficient is really good. So our last slide, I think, the next one. So our newsletter, the inaugural issue was last Friday, and I think everyone got it. I know we sent it out to about 900 emails by Monday. So we sent it out on Friday. By Monday, we had added, I think, 120 new people that had subscribed to it. So that was pretty incredible. We're going to expand our newsletter to include the Human Services distribution list. And tomorrow's edition will have the Corona Meter, symptoms and testing, So we're finding people don't know what the symptoms are, and that 4 days between someone getting or feeling like they have symptoms and then going for a test. So we're trying to attack that piece of data, how contact tracing works. The community survey we'll be promoting. And then from the human service side, food and economic assistance, quarantine support, and then the business messaging will go on there. When you go to the COVID website, right on the top right-hand corner, you put your email in and subscribe, and anyone can get the newsletter. And we're feeling that we really need to be able to push out information to people who want it. This is just a once a week publication. And so it'll be a summary. It will have Board of Health links to what the summary that we produce from this, when the community meetings are. So it's a way, just another way for people to get information. Everybody doesn't read our website. So here's another version. And I think that's my last one.
Thank you very much. Karen, who's up next?
Let's see. I think Suzuhu, I think we were not sure what we're doing with this one. I think we had already talked about this, but.
Not aware.
Okay, maybe it's Kara. I think this is lining up with our corona meter, looking at the low risk, our mitigation plan in the yellow zone with control measures. We are working on building this out on our website so that the corona meter will be there. It'll have the current conditions and control measures that are in place. And then there'll also be an opportunity for people to look through all four of these levels of the corona meter and understand what control measures may be considered in each one of those phases. So people can have an idea if we're in a high yellow rating that they could go into the orange and see, well, what might happen there. We're trying to make it control measures that are being considered, not that this will automatically take place, because we know the variables of this disease and what's happening in our community are pretty wild, wide. And then with the phased rollback, so as a safer at home and what phases will be in that. So we're trying to make it on our website so all of these four levels are easy to understand and people can understand where we are today. So I knew what they were. I wasn't sure I was covering it. So there you go.
Great job. Karen?
So, I think I sound like Darth Vader.
A little.
I don't know if you can hear me. Sorry that my microphone is really messing up. Can we move Lindsay to the next slide?
Okay, Karen caught the virus that was in Kurt's camera.
So I think we have a little bit of time to talk about other topics that the board wanted to bring up. I might need someone else to take the lead on this if you can't hear me well, but Kara, I knew there were a couple other pieces that we were gonna cover.
Yeah, it's very scratchy there, Karen. So I'm gonna ask Suzuho to take the lead for Karen. Can you do that, Suzuho?
Sure, yeah, we can kind of go around robin. I think we were envisioning having each of the board members, if you have something that you've been hearing in the community or have a question for us, and then something that you have picked up from today's presentation that you are willing to kind of carry forward out into the community over the next couple of weeks to help be amplifiers for us as well. So
yeah, I do have somewhat of a It's a worry, it's a scare to one particular sector. And I will come back, but I saw Patty's hand go up first. And Patty?
Yeah, thank you. And by the way, sorry I came on late. It was a little confusing, but I'm filling in for Greg, who is out of cell reception right now. So he's unable to participate. You know, when we changed the number of gatherings from 50 to 10, I don't think that we had anticipated the number of events that were planned to occur with greater than 10 people. And I got hit with a lot of people calling me, contacting me. And one of the primary concerns was people who were having private events in their own homes. And the feeling that the county was overstepping their bounds by trying to control something that was happening on a private sector level. And I just want to clarify, it's my understanding that when we're under pandemic or emergency health issues, that we have the authority then to manage things that are such as private events happening in private homes. Can somebody clarify that for me, just to be sure? Because people are getting very upset and I'm fielding those calls and trying to get them to the right person or persons to help them with their events.
Suzuho, and I also see John Peacock on.
I'm going to say Jordana can address that.
Thank you.
I'm going to hop off and come back.
I can take the current process of what is allowable, and then John, maybe if you can hop in with the legal regulatory authority, that would be helpful. So currently the process for we have limited informal events to a maximum of 10 people. Those events that are 11 to 50 people continue to be permitted, but they need to meet some qualifications. So for those events that are happening in a private home, they would require a dedicated event coordinator, a professional event coordinator. So this is someone who is already has a business safety plan on file and will file an event safety plan for the event. And the reasoning behind that is really that when we look at the data and what we're seeing is that's where a lot of the spread is happening. And so we know that the events that are taking place where they are putting into place all of the practices and the guidance that we've laid out, they can happen safely. But somebody needs to be accountable for that in order for that to happen. So Patty, if you're getting those calls, those private events, just need to have a designated professional event coordinator putting an event safety plan on file. And then the other events, if they require a permit, I'm sorry, they're weed whacking outside. Can you still hear me?
Okay. We can hear you.
So other types of events, if they require a permit from 11 to 50, if you get the permit, you can still submit an event safety plan. And then also for events that are happening in restaurants or hotel ballrooms, places that already have kind of like a one standing event, safety plan for all of the things that they do in those kinds of situations, those are still permitted. So I will pass along to John for the kind of legal side of things, and all of that is detailed on the website as well.
Yeah, real quick, let me just jump in. In that graph that you have that shows this type of event, that type, you know, the one that you sent me the slide of, that was extremely helpful. I passed that on to people who have contacted me, and I do understand the process. It's that a lot of the people holding the private events aren't happy with it, as you can imagine.
And Patty, John Ely would be better to answer this question, but yes, under Title 25, the Public Health Director and separately the Board of Health have authority when it's reasonably necessary to protect public health to implement these types of restrictions. And these types of restrictions have been recommended at the national level, the state level, and in fact, implemented at the state level, as well as the local level. And in Colorado, it's Title 25 that gives the authority to put those.
Yeah. Thanks, John. That's what I thought. I just wanted the rest of the board to hear that in case they were going to be getting calls from people questioning whether or not we have the authority to go into private homes. And I think during a pandemic, we do.
Brent?
Yeah, as usual, I've got probably more questions than solutions, but to me, this goes to the fact of messaging again, that there's always some confusion. There's always some interpretation. And one of our burdens, as far as I'm concerned, and this is true nationally, I think, is to come out with clear, straight, concise statements. And those statements typically can't parse the problem. They really need to be, in my view, grand statements, simple statements, wear a mask, it's the law, that kind of thing. And to Patty's statement about that she's had some complaints and such. Now I have too, and it seems to me that the complaints that I get are almost in a way, not that they're politically related, but they're much like the debate in the country. I have people that, you know, basically guard their private freedoms and you shouldn't have, you know, we should have certain rights, and they refuse to discuss the fact that those rights impinge on others. But I get a much bigger cross-section of people that tell me we're not doing enough. They're saying to me, your messages are confusing. I want to do the right thing. I don't know what to do. The board needs to be proactive and much stronger in its decisions, which means they need to take some chances, because we know for sure we're starting out behind. We wake up every day behind this thing, at least 10 days, 14 days, whatever. So whatever we do, we're going to have to do way prospectively. And that's under the assumption that that's even the right thing we do. But in my view, doing anything is better than doing nothing, so that we should somehow move forward. And trying to get a clear message is a national issue, and it's certainly, in my view, an issue for the board, and a really difficult one, because it gets into personal freedoms, it gets into how you put a message together that resonates and so forth. Anyway, that's all I wanted to say, is that there's the other side to this complaint side, is that I get people telling me, you guys aren't doing enough. It's a little too generic. It's too diffuse. Anyway, thanks.
Well, I think it'll be really interesting to have a regional communication strategy, which Phyllis touched on as well.
Exactly right.
Consistency is so important. And in the chat box, I don't know if any one of you popped on it, Josh posted the statistics for what's going on in Eagle County and Garfield, which gives me a little pause. And that is, there are a lot of cases. Eagle County just popped up big time. What, 150, Josh, was it?
Their site says 170 in the past 2 weeks.
I mean, oh Lordy. And likewise, Garfield is up as well. So anything that we can do I think the message has to be strong, strong vigilance right now. Because however those counties go, it seems that we kind of follow. And to that end, I did receive a question early this morning. I have several, and this probably needs to be answered, hopefully by Karen, but perhaps Suzuho or John. We are all aware of what was in the newspaper over the weekend. And the question becomes one of the enforcement side. And we know that a respective business has been closed for 30 days or so. The question that I got from another community member here in Snowmass was, to what extent are there fines? To what extent is jail time, those types of things being considered? And is that within the authority of the public health director? So John, maybe you need to answer that one. And I see Tom.
I can answer that if my voice is okay. Is it good? All right. So yes, it is with the public health director's authority to enforce on CRS 25 number, I can't think of it off the top of my head. Right now that can include a fine up to $15,000 or jail time. And we're talking with the attorney's office tomorrow to discuss what are our next steps with this particular case.
Thank you, Karen. Likewise, does the state have this second part of that question from the community member, to what extent is the state going to act or has acted? And I can't answer that question because I don't know the answer.
Sure, so any time a local community does not want to enforce or does not have the ability to enforce, those cases can be pushed to the state attorney general, who also has the ability to enforce on state public health orders or governor's executive orders. And so you may have heard about some of those cases throughout the state of Colorado right now. The Attorney General, I think, has issued maybe 35 cease and desist letters. The Attorney General is the one that is looking at that Weld County rodeo scenario that happened, where there were, I think, it potentially 1,000 people that were heading in that direction. So the state has the ability to enforce as well. And so that's just kind of a negotiation between local communities and the state around that. But again, the state's enforcing on the state order. We have kind of a mix of different things happening here, that we have our own public health order. There are also like the executive orders that come from the governor are also another piece that that impact our community, like the no selling of alcohol after 10 p.m. So that's a state executive order.
Thank you for that answer. Tom, did you have a question? You're muted, Tom. Tom, you're muted. Unmute yourself. Okay.
Thank you. I am all for the enforcement and follow-up of the Bootsy Bellows cases.
Thank you. And now I would, if there's any other questions relative to these types of issues, let me go on to another issue that came to my attention early this morning. And it comes really from the child care community. And we all want our kids to eventually get back at school. We know we have some young kids going to some type of a daycare. We have multiple daycare centers, and we do want to keep all of those in business. But here is the issue. Needless to say, it's kind of hard to get kids to wear a mask, little kids, as one example. And there's so many regulations so associated with the little kids, and being a teacher in one of those organizations, I can't imagine the stress that causes each and every minute of every school day for these little ones and to the teachers and their helpers. The question, the issue was the fact that there's fear that they're going to be closed. There's fear that they're going to have to go out of business, because apparently if they accepted some of the CARES Act, the PPP, they have to not only pay a teacher who may test positive, who goes into quarantine for 10 days or so, they also have to pay the substitute teacher. So you can imagine the financial impact on a very, very tight margin type of a business. They're lucky to break even. And the question is what our county or what we can do to assure them that we want them to stay in business. I know there's in the process of signing new lease agreements, 3 months, 6 months, or 9 months, and they're worried they might go out of business during that period of time if they get into this hassle in terms of paying for their teachers and subs. And I think it's very important that maybe someone from that sector who's designed the business plan work with them, but I'd love to find a way, and this is a John Peacock, of course, or Aspen, or even Snowmass, is let's make sure we keep these daycare centers financially whole. And it'll be an issue I'll take up with my town council on Monday night. John, have you heard some of these types of issues as well?
We've certainly heard challenges with the child care centers being able to remain open, and just how important they are to keeping our economy going.
Marky, can I add to that? In reading the governor's recent, information, he has highlighted child care. He said as one of the areas that he's looking at to seek funding, either statewide or federal specific to keeping the child cares open, especially with the fact they also have to, some of them have to cut back their numbers because of social distancing, et cetera, issues. So that might be something we need to keep an eye on and make sure that we're supportive of that at both the state and federal level to get some monies coming from that direction to help us out.
Thank you, Patty. In fact, Karen, who is coordinating the child care from the sector business and the team?
We've been working with them specifically around like quarantine and isolation and guidance around cleanliness and that kind of thing. So not necessarily on the economic side of this, but Carlin and Josh have been working directly with the child cares and Kurt as well on the public health side.
Let's keep that on our radar screen in terms of what the governor is proposing, et cetera.
And if you need me to be a contact on that, both through CCI or whatever, just let me know, since I have a vested interest with childcare in my family. So I'm more than willing to help you guys out wherever I can.
Thank you very, very much, Patty. And if several people are on the community call today and listening to the meeting, please also reach out to Patty. Okay, please. Other questions and other things you're hearing in the community? I saw another item that was popped into the chat room a little while ago. Bill Manson, can you unmute yourself? You and Josh, and talk about your issue.
Yeah, thanks, Marky. I was just chatting with Josh because I'm hearing that people are going down to Valley View to get testing because they can turn around tests in one day, whereas AVH is taking longer than that. Is that, and he was saying it's a rapid test, but maybe Kim can tell us, do they do turnaround testing quicker at Valley View than they do at AVH?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that. So it is a similar test. It's just a in-house lab test that has an hour to turnaround time, which is a very similar test that Aspen has. The issue that occurred there was there's now tri-county strategy on testing, which Karen had mentioned, and because of these high turnaround times and limited testing that we currently have, and hopefully things will change at some point soon, the tri-county plan now is a very focused strategy on testing only symptomatic people, and then also people who have been having significant exposures who may be asymptomatic, but important for public health, box it in. And so that strategy has been accepted now. The Valley View, it was at that same time that this strategy was being developed. And so that did occur to a number of individuals where they felt that Valley View would have a faster test. It's not a faster test, it's an in-house test, but now we're using those in-house tests with a lot more strategy and focus, and Valley View is doing the same thing. So it's really for only symptomatic individuals. And we're all working together now, which I think is a much better strategy overall for testing, being that it has been one of the most difficult issues throughout this entire pandemic. And we all hope that there are more resources and shorter turnaround times and we wouldn't have to have issues like this, but that has been changed now. So thank you, Bill, for bringing that up.
So I guess the other part of that is some people need to get a negative test before they can go back to work if they've been exposed. So how are we dealing with those cases?
It's a great question. So we have testing available, and it is just not the in-house rapid testing. So if you need to go back to work and there is a requirement for that can't be changed, or any other situation that you're in, there's a test that's a send-out test that is just as good, and it turnaround time now for that maybe up to 3 days. It varies a little bit, but you just have to plan ahead a little bit and get that test in time and know that, you know what, we're in this testing situation where you're gonna get the test that's a send out test for that situation. And the very limited supply of in-house lab testing at the hospitals are really reserved for people who are extremely sick or really need that turnaround time in an hour. So
going back to work, just plan ahead. Or if you're traveling, just plan ahead several days. Know it's going to take several days and put that into your schedule at this point. Is that helpful, Bill?
Yes, thank you. I think that's really helpful. I think for those people who have been contacted and they say, okay, I can't go to work for a few days, you know, those, I think that's where we run into some issues with people not wanting to be part of the contact tracing because they can't go back to work until they provide that negative test.
I'm wondering if Josh can just speak to that really quickly about their relationship with employers and testing. There.
I mean, I could just comment that.
Actually, he just unmuted, sorry.
Go ahead, Kim, I can join.
Oh no, go ahead, Josh.
So, you know, in general, we don't ask that individuals that are going back to work be tested. And I think CDC has now removed that guidance from their website as well, as has CDPHE. And that's, you know, that's because, you know, someone can test positive for months, right? For weeks and up to months at times. So we don't really, you know, we try to discourage using testing to allow someone to return to work. And we really just try to use a time-based strategy, which is what CDPHE and CDC are both recommending. So as much as possible, as much as we can, you know, really encourage that using that time-based strategy, I think we'll be better off.
And can I add that when somebody does test positive, negative test does not relieve them from the requirements of isolation. And again, that's because we have a high false negative rate. So if you have a positive test, you have to isolate for that minimum 10-day period that we talked about. Same with contacts. If you're a contact of somebody who tested positive and you have to quarantine, we do not release you from those requirements with a negative test. So I think they're we just want to make sure that we're clear that this idea of going back to work, you still have to fulfill those isolation or quarantine requirements before you can even get to that point.
Absolutely. And just one more point in that there is testing still has up to a 20% false negative rate. And so, you know, if you have COVID-like symptoms, it's treated as if you have it. Even if you have a negative test, there may be cases in the contact tracing, quarantine, and isolation that will be considered positive and for all the right reasons. The tests are not perfect.
Kim, this is Linda. I have a question for you. I've had several patients in the last couple of weeks that have had a fever at night and nothing during the day, and they've all tested negative for COVID-19. Do you have any information on that?
I mean, certainly fever is one of those symptoms that alone can define as having COVID-like symptoms and require a test. Again, there's false negative, there's other viruses always going around. And so we're in this difficult world where we don't know, is that another virus? It could be. Do we have to treat this like COVID because we're in a pandemic? I think so. And that's the difficult thing. It's a hard part of having to isolate when you have a negative test. And to say that, you know, that's okay to go back, it's a really difficult thing to do. It's a tight spot. But I think you're always the right thing to do in you know, defense of Kurt and the contact tracing, quarantine, isolation is the right thing to do is if you have symptoms that are in meet the definition that you have to treat it like COVID.
Thank you. Good question, Linda. Other questions? Anything else you're hearing out there in the community? Yes, Jeannie, good to see you.
I am sorry, I had technical issues, so I got on late. But I do want to make a comment that there is something on everybody's mind, which is whether their kids are going to go back to school. And I've been hearing a lot about a subset of teachers who are quite fearful about going back to school. And we understand this virus can be devastating in young people. And we know that there's risk to this virus. But I also know that the school district is doing many things to help mitigate those risks. For example, they've ordered 12,000 surgical masks for the teachers, so every teacher can have one a day. They've also ordered face masks. They're working on having cohorts, small cohorts of kids, and they're working on sanitizing and increasing ventilation. And I just wonder if anyone else has heard other things. And they're also forming smaller task force groups so the teachers can be heard. And so that's just my comment, that that's what I'm hearing in the town.
I heard the same thing earlier this morning from a teacher. So when I was out walking this morning with my dogs. So it's worrisome, it's scary, but I personally, and Karen, you can comment as well, because I know you're working with the school as well. I think it's so important that I applaud everything the school system is doing to keep it's a safe environment for teachers and for kiddos. So Karen?
Sure, yeah, and I think we recognize that no scenario out there is risk-free, that we're really thinking about safer schools, and the school district has really gone through a process of looking, you know, at guidance. I think they're in the process of actually revamping their guidance right now, and we'll be working with them on that revamp of the guidance to be able to be consultants in this work with them, allowing our medical advisory team to help us to better understand from a public health perspective, what are the medical components to be considering, and really bringing a public health lens to being consultants to the school district as they move forward and figure out what the best learning environment is for kiddos here in our community. And boy, you know, this is really hard for, I would say, for administrators, for teachers, for parents. Wow, you know, there's probably nothing that's more impactful to communities right now than making these decisions and really trying to think about risk, you know, your own levels of risk, personally, your levels of risk for your kids, levels of risk in the school. And so, you know, the goal is to mitigate for risk and to really think about all the different factors that can go into that. And luckily we have some good research, both medical and public health research, about how to do that. And then I think there are some unknowns in the pandemic world. We know that, you know, there's some good studies that have come out, but they're, you know, sort of few and far between studies. And there's not a lot of peer-reviewed information because we're just learning from schools around the world that have been open and what have been their successful practices, and where they've seen some hiccups or challenges. And you know, what's happening in Colorado is not unique to the country right now. And what we feel like, as I mentioned sort of in the beginning of this meeting, is that our goal as public health is to bring the best data. Those metrics that we've been talking about with the chronometer are really the metrics we're bringing to the school district for them to make informed decisions based on data. And then we all have a responsibility in this community, every single one of us, to maintain the five commitments to containment, to think about the three C's, to do the things we've all been talking about for a long time, because what we do on the individual and community level impacts the schools. They are a microcosm of our community. And so really we all play a role in helping those schools to be able to function in the way that they decide that they want to function. And we recognize the implications to kiddos' learning if they're not in person. We recognize the implications to parents. All of those factors are it's so complex, but really the things that we do every day, the decisions we make every day can actually impact how schools can function. And I think that's the awareness I would like the community to be thinking of.
Thank you very much. Kim?
Yeah, Mark, thanks. I just wanted to make a quick comment and echo a lot of what Karen just said. Which I really support and agree with in terms of the complexity of this decision. From the medical community, the medical advisory team, we've looked at a lot of the data. It's very limited in terms of recommendations, and each community really needs to make their own decision. From a medical point of view, there is an incredible benefit to in-person learning for children, and just the benefits in the long-term development, the intellectual, emotional, social, There are a lot of benefits to in-person learning. And then on the other side, there are risks, as we know, and how do you weigh those risks? And each, I think it's each county and then each individual needs to weigh that risk and benefit. We know the five commitments work. We know masks work. We know social distancing works. And we know that the schools are working incredibly hard to put these in place. And so the risk can be lowered and mitigated. And so all of those measures lower your risk. It will never be zero. And I think, you know, each teacher needs to make their own risk benefit kind of analysis. And of course, some teachers will be at more risk for disease. So again, I applaud the schools. It's such a difficult decision. And we do hope that some in-person learning to some extent can happen if it's deemed safe. And our community transmission rate really will play into that significantly. So again, we're all responsible and hopeful to keep transmission rate low. So to give the schools that opportunity if they decide to do that.
Thank you, Kim. Any other person wants to make any comments? If not, we'll turn our attention. Tori, go ahead.
Thanks very much. Mine are really quick. This past Tuesday, Aspen City Council had a joint meeting with the BOCC. We had John, Karen, and Josh join us from County Health and gave us kind of some overview about where we are. My comments would really just be about, you know, our continued desire for testing availability. We recognize that turnaround time has been something that's in our way for that, but we do still support improved testing availability here. Visitor tracing and registration is something that we are wondering about, trying to get a clearer picture about our visitors on their way here, making initial contact even before they travel here, to know, so that they know what we've got going on for guidelines and regulations, but also so that they know how they can best protect our community as they are entering it for the remainder of the summer and such. We had, you know, a lot of conversation about what's coming up and just trying to think outside the box for ideas like infrastructure improvements. What are we gonna do about capacity in restaurants as we move towards winter and off-season weather that won't really be conducive to uncovered outdoor dining. The City Council very much put an ask to the BOCC for their input on any of these items and using their perspective and their regional view to help us with some of the questions that we're facing. So we had, you know, a good conversation on Tuesday. Again, as Brent said, there's still a lot of questions out there more than there are answers. And we're just looking for any input as we're moving forward. The regional testing was also suggesting that a regional testing strategy was also brought up in that meeting as well. So I just wanted to report to you that, you know, we have had conversations with the BOCC and County Health, and you know, we're here to support. Obviously communication is key and something that we all want to take part in, but I think we're all really on that precipice of next answers, next levels. We've gotten a tremendous amount of information over the last couple months. Hopefully that's going to guide us towards some of our safest practices. As I continue to say, to me, this virus is not widespread, it's widely spread. What I mean by that is it's not rampant, it's not everywhere, but even it being somewhere a little bit is still a threat to our community. So it's very hard. This is a very difficult pandemic and virus to get our hands around and really contain it. But I feel like, I'll say this from my own point of view, not from councils, but I feel like we're doing a really good job here. And kudos to all those that are on this board and that are working with County Health. I think we're doing a really good job. Again, like I said, a really good job still has some of that outlying threat and danger. So we're not out of the woods by any means, but I really feel confident that the team that's been put together over the county is going to be doing a continued great job. And we're just looking for our way to help and participate, be supportive, and also take some input from others. So that goes to Snowmass Village, County, you name it, any board members here, we're looking for answers. The one thing that I do hear from the community is still, you know, that mask agreement. A lot of trail users are still kind of you know, wishy-washy about covering up as they're passing or approaching and passing people. Things like that, just continuing to get that mask up message out there is something that we're still working on. And that's the number one thing that I hear, though. So thanks so much. I just wanted to throw that in there.
Thank you very, very much, Tori. I totally agree with your comments about the quality of the staff that have been hired, and the presentations that were made today. It really speaks to the county's commitment to make sure we're fully staffed and having all the tools that our team in the public health department really need to do what their mission is to do, and that is to protect the health of our community, the health and safety of everyone. So that's awesome. Now we're gonna turn to the agenda for 2 weeks from now. And Karen, have you thought a little bit about what we might want to include 2 weeks from now? Hopefully we have a school plan that we can talk about. Hopefully we will have our data. Josh, you present so nicely, so thank you. And Kim, we would want you on that call. And then are we gonna be looking at sector specific and some more work on the mitigation plan, Karen? So.
Yeah, and I this is definitely an opportunity for the board to weigh in on what topics they would like to bring forth in 2 weeks. I don't think we'll probably have any, I'm guessing no policy decisions on the public health order if things continue to sort of bump along like they are as far as our numbers. We might see some things coming from the state, so I think we should just be prepared for that, but I can't necessarily look in the crystal ball to know what that is, but there are some dialogues happening at the state level that we could bring back pending actually a task force that John Peacock is on right now and talking about some guidance that the White House has given to each state in the nation and how the state of Colorado is going to interpret that guidance and manifest that guidance out. So John, or I might just pitch to you for a second, but that could be a thing that we could bring up for sure.
Yeah, no, Karen, I think that'd be a good idea. The task force, I think, was put together very quickly. In fact, I think we got an email earlier this week, and the first meeting was last night, and the second meeting was this morning. And basically, it's going through both the White House guidance, but also Dr. Frieden's work, which all of you have seen. Which is the resolve to save lives. He's a former director of the CDC. And basically what the state is trying to do is really look at where is there opportunities to create consistency between what the federal government is looking at and what other reputable organizations are recommending to have a gradient step in for the protect your neighbor phase. So what it means in English is that the metrics that we use to evaluate how successful we are in containing the virus and whether we're ready to go on to a next step of reopening are all being relooked at the state level. So that would potentially have a big impact on us. And there's still a lot of conversations that need to happen.
Brent, you have a question or a comment?
Well, yeah, just before we all go, just so that I'm clear, you know, to Tori's point, which in Europe, you can't check into a hotel without surrendering your passport. They know who you are, they know how to get to you. And of course, typically they don't, but except maybe to get you a cappuccino or something. But from our standpoint, should we not discuss and take a position on exactly that kind of capability? I guess that infringes on certain freedoms, perhaps, but in an emergency situation, why do we not, and I mean this sincerely, why do we not do a temperature check at the airport? And regardless of how effective it is something that we can do. And in the future, it may be something that we wish we had done. And to to bring everybody in and maybe even catch them before they get on the airplane, but get some sort of data. They can sign a release with the airline. The airline could probably give us this stuff. They could sign a release with the airline. Is it okay, the public health officials get your passenger data? We would get it automatically. We probably would get it electronically, which would even be better. We wouldn't even have to write it down and then transfer it. And if we don't need this stuff, well, then we overreacted and, you know, we can think about that later. But if we do need this stuff, this is 28%, 25% of our inbound passengers that we could, would be super helpful to imagine in terms of tracing. But if somebody on an airplane got sick, bang, we know who was on the airplane. We know their cell numbers. We know how to get hold of them. And I'm not sure that even the hotel shouldn't do exactly the same thing. I think they have it, but somehow getting overreacting, I guess is what I'm saying. Overreacting, I think, is a good thing. But
yeah, Brenton, we've certainly been looking at all of that, and there are some significant challenges. There's a national organization of airport executives that is working with the FAA to try and make some rule changes so that exactly what you're talking about can happen on the national level. Right. It is a real challenge to think about just doing it at one airport and not doing it within the whole system, as you can imagine. We've been looking at the screening kind of logistics, right, for people coming off of aircraft. And you know, just so this board knows, I think I've shared this before, our commercial employments are down quite a bit. They're down 97.9% in April. They're down 89.2% in May. And they were down 82.7% in June. And June was our high month since March, and we had 3,800 people come through the airport. But I think we're seeing that there's air travel's coming back a little bit. So if we got to a 50% kind of mark, Brent,
yeah,
and we wanted to have a half hour wait time for folks to get into the terminal, and we assume about 2 minutes per screen by the time people come up, get screened, get moved on. We would need probably 10 to 15 people to do that. And so that's what we're trying to evaluate. Is that the best use of our time and our resources? Or is it working with the airlines? The airlines have started doing screening. United is doing symptom screening. We have actually had passengers turned away at our airport based on that symptom screening. To me, that's a better system than potentially having a whole airplane load that once it lands, what do you do with them, right?
Well, I completely agree with you. And to the extent that we can get the airlines to do this, I think that's great. My only point is, should we take a position on this? And this is again for the attorneys, but basically strongly recommend that in the interest of public safety, this is what we feel. Now, if we run up against static or pushback, mm-hmm. So what? Goes with the turf, not a big deal. But at least we can say we were on the right side of history and we tried to stop it as best we could.
Yeah, and I think there are opportunities for this board to weigh in both at the state level as well as the federal level to encourage systems, because that's where it needs to happen.
Right.
So yeah, I think that's a perfectly appropriate advocacy role for this board. Yeah,
perfect. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very, very much. Any other business to come forward to today's session? If not, we're at 3:27. I'll see if.
Yep.
Motion to adjourn. Thank you, Drew.
Thank you, Tom.
I'll make a second.
Love it, Tori.
Love it, Tori. No business.
That's right. Okay, good night. I mean, goodbye, everybody.